Start at the beginning. So was Webb and Giffords, was that your first job on the waterfront?
First job on the waterfront. My first job in New Westminster was in the Trust Building.
Oh, wow.
For Imperial Optical.
Oh, really?
And they were, I think, the first floor, if not the second.
Yeah.
And they were one of the premier optical companies in British Columbia.
You're talking about the Red Brick Building, right?
Yes.
Oh, it's still there. We haven't replaced that building. It's still in place. The Ample Center's beside it.
Oh,
going
I
back
see.
To what you mentioned earlier
oh,
about it,
yeah.
replacing that one.
Yeah.
It's still there.
So that was my first flavor of working in New Westminster. And it was an inside office job. And I used to walk from there in my lunch hour straight down 8th Street onto the dock. And BC Packers were there. And that was, for me, the liberation from this horrible office environment. And the fish boats would come in there loaded with salmon.
Mm. But what year was that?
I can give it to you. That would have been 1952. And I would say that, yes, the summer of 52, because they were coming in loaded with salmon, and that would be the summer catch of sockeye and other species of salmon. The fish boats, it was a fairly high dock from the river itself, even in freshet, and they would load up their fish boxes down there in the hold of the small fish boats, and mm-hmm. then haul them up with a winch and swing them and land them on the dock. And in some cases, immediately start throwing ice on top of them, crushed ice. And then they would slide from there and go into the interior of this BC Packers warehousing process. Now, I'm going to have to use conjecture because it was, an industrial site. I didn't wander inside of it. But my conjecture is they certainly weren't going from there into a freezer containment.
Mm-hmm.
They must have been going into processing. You cleaned, and whether they were cleaned and then moved from there out to the fresh markets as fresh fish, I assume they probably were. I don't remember it being a cannery.
Okay.
Now, interestingly enough, and we didn't know that in our history before we married, and
mm-hmm.
we've only been married for 3 years.
Mm-hmm.
But Alin's mom worked for BC Packers right down there on the waterfront.
Oh, wow.
The office.
In the office.
Yeah.
So,
wow.
Yeah, like,
Sorry.
Dude. rather
Serious.
Odd. And so I'm sure this could add to the story of what BC Packers did, but she's up in Armstrong Mitts.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll try and pull some of this memory from her.
Mm.
But it... as an environmentalist, you'll see that I'll dig into the corners here,
mm-hmm.
because as I look back, I'm horrified as to the way we treated the Fraser River. If they were cleaning and gutting the fish there, and I assume they were, I know where the entrails were going, and because Webb and Giffords had just hatches in the floor of the machine shop,
mm-hmm.
and everything that was the leftovers from the machining, the oil, carbon tetrachloride, the cutting fluids, which of course is outlawed now, all of that went straight down into the Fraser River because we were on pilings and the currents of the river actually swept right under our building.
Oh. Okay.
And when a ship was docking or came up hard against our wharf edge, I was being tied to the bollards. We could feel the actual shake of
oh,
the
wow.
whole building. So you can appreciate that where you have large lathes which are turning off steel ravelings that come off like hay,
mm-hmm.
Every day the janitor would be sweeping the machine shop floor and he'd just sweep it towards the hatch, open it up, and
oh.
down it would go into the river. So... and all the toilets for the office and for the machine shop, it was just a straight pipe
oh
and it was
my.
In the river.
Oh, goodness.
So that's part of the history of the, the Fraser was seen as a never-ending receptacle
mm-hmm.
for anything you wish to dump to where we are today. We still have issues, but we have certainly moved a long way. So I was going back to where I worked for Imperial Optical and going down there, and mm-hmm. then I certainly became well convinced by the fall of the year that I didn't want to work inside in that clustered environment, and I thought I was mechanically inclined, and I started to apply for an apprenticeship, and I went all around the Lower Mainland, and I finally got two offers, one for the CN at the CN shops on the banks of the Fraser there, and the other one was Webb and Giffords, and Webb and Giffords were unique, and I was advised by a relative, pick them because they're a general machine shop, and mm-hmm. they do everything. And if you go to the CN shops, they're specialized in railway axles and, you know, the machining of just railway equipment.
Right.
And that advice certainly bore out. Webb and Giffords did everything.
Mm-hmm.
You just talked about the Patella Bridge. I can remember going up there and being a little bit stressed that, like in those days, they didn't have flag people or whatever. You put up a sign. We hauled up the portable welder, which was still fairly unique in those days to have the portable gas-driven welder. And we'd go up onto the bridge and start repairing or welding the railings on the bridge. And the traffic would be just clipping by you like that. And no flag people or anything, you know. Coming back directly to the machine shop, as I remember it, when I first started there, I don't think Swiftshore, there was a dock there, I don't think Swiftshore owned it at the time. They did sometimes later, and for years they had their boats tie up there, and they were ocean-going tugs.
Mm-hmm.
The difference, a big difference between a river tug and an ocean-going tug. An ocean-going tug has to be certified by the Department of Transport. At one point it was the Ministry of Transport, and then I think Department of Transport, that a naval architect has to certify that it can go offshore safely, and it has to be a deep hull, and
mm-hmm.
you know, and all the provisions for taking heavy weather in big seas. Swiftshore was unique in that they had these ocean-going tugs, at least two of them that tied up there, and then it separated, and then there was another set of pilings, and that was Augustine Cole, and then it separated again, and then there was Webb and Giffords, which was a machine shop and a blacksmith shop.
Okay.
And then there was some separation, like I say, because this would be out into the river, and then the river would come in like that, and then it would go back out again. And then at some point during my apprenticeship, there was a businessmen's group came together in New West. Maybe they had a federal grant too. I know Stu Gifford had put money into it, and they built what they called Overseas Transport Dock.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the main dock that you see there today.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And then that dock made it a continuous stop process from Augustine Cole going right down past Webb and Giffords, and then it would be into this overseas transport.
Mm.
And there was big storage sheds there. And New West was really moving into, with the railway right alongside of it, hoping to become an international shipping port.
Right.
And bringing in the products of British Columbia and transporting them from there. That's the first stanza.
So what was your job like when you started at Webb and Giffords? How did they start you off in your training as an apprentice?
A lovely question. I love it. A pair of this was 1952, a pair of coveralls made to feel that and I'm not complaining, but every dirty job, a lot of broken machinery came into the shop, and it usually had an amount of grease or grime on it. A good training for an apprentice was to start them off on that basis, clean it up so I can have a look at it and see what's wrong with it. And I think on the, but you know, they moved you ahead very quickly. Mm-hmm. I started at 50 cents an hour, which was standard apprenticeship rate. Within 6 months, I was going to be moved up to 75 cents an hour. And then I think at the end of a year, I was a dollar an hour. And I was trying to find means of transport from Port Coquitlam into New West on 50 cents an hour. And I borrowed $100, bought a 1930 Dodge, and was driving this wooden-spoked car that had lots of issues.
Oh, my.
Into New West and back. And I found it financially extremely difficult, but I was tenacious, and there was two. I found two other apprentices in the shop too, and we kind of banded together, young fellas, and we were certainly tested. On the third day of the job, I was using a power hacksaw to cut a piece of round cold rolled steel, mm-hmm. and it came in from the Vancouver warehouses coated in grease to protect its fine finish. And I was wiping that down to get the grease off it so it could be handled and then cut. And it was on rollers, steel rollers, and it suddenly shifted and dropped off one roller and smashed my finger and still deformed. And anyway... the foreman came down and looked at it and said, I hope you're not going to be one of those accident-prone kids that I've hired.
Oh, my gosh.
sent me down to the doctor, and they put a bit of a splint on it and bandaged it up. And even though there was workman's compensation board, I was sent back to work and continued the rest of the day with, just on painkillers. So... you toughened up quickly under that environment, and I certainly found that a lot of the men were real characters, and the blacksmith especially, he an extremely enjoyable chap. So I found it very interesting. I found it very demanding. I found it very dangerous. Mm-hmm. All three of the apprentices during their apprenticeship did injure themselves. Mm-hmm. This was just a minor one. One had his finger ripped off in the belts under a lathe. Other one was grinding with a portable hand grinder, and he was down on his knees, and it touched the concrete and suddenly walked because it got traction right into his knee and cut him right down to the bone.
God.
And interestingly enough, we had a little first aid shop, and they'd rush you in there, and they would have a bottle like this of wound cleanser, mm-hmm. and it was carbon tetrachloride. it was a degreasing agent, an amazing degreasing agent, and they just flushed the wound with it. And I think I was there for at least 2 years before we got notification from the Workman's Compensation Board. Then, of course, it's a carcinogen, and it was not to be used for wound cleansing. And then they came out with Dettol and others. But safety, they tried, but, you know, it was the conditions of the day. Now, you know, in hardening steel, it has to be allied with a certain amount. The first thing I learned, you know, I thought steel was hard. And I thought, you know, if you wanted it harder, you just put it in a forge and you heated it and quenched it.
Right.
And then I was told by the blacksmith, it has to have a certain percentage of carbon. You've got to draw the carbon with the heat process. And but there was another way to harden it where it was just going to get a certain amount of friction on the outside, not stress or strains. In other words, the tensile... ability was not going to improve by carbon necessarily. You could do it cheaply and do it with cyanide.
Mm-hmm.
And what you'd do is take your cyanide crystals and put them in a pot, put them on a forge, and heat them up until they became liquid. And that liquid and starting to glow would be about 1200 degrees. And then you would take your steel that, not big chunks of steel, but steels that were going to have an abrasion and needed to be hardened, you would flip them with tongs into this hot cyanide.
Mm-hmm.
And then I was thoroughly warned to be extremely careful, because then you reach into this liquid cyanide, you reach out with the steel, and you have a bucket over there, a 5-gallon bucket of water, and you flip it into the water for a quick quench.
Oh, yeah.
And you get an amazingly hard surface out of this. And they had just always said, do not get your tongs wet, or do not ever get water into the cyanide, the liquid cyanide in it. Okay. I think they might have even said it will explode, but
mm-hmm.
anyway, that's... And then one day I was doing this, and all I know is the whole... The pot was right inside of a forge,
mm-hmm.
and there was the air, or the bellows assembly, was an electric motor feeding the air to make the coals very hot, and in turn this pot of cyanide. And I was working on it this day, and it was just boom, and my face was burning, my eyes were shut, and I was just, you know, just like that. It was just my whole face was on fire.
Oh, wow.
And that beautiful blacksmith, he grabbed me by the back of the neck and dragged me going backwards, because, you know, I was just on fire. And he got me into the washroom, shoved my head under the cold water, and held it there.
Wow.
And I had big black burn marks all over my face. And luckily, my reactions were fast enough, because my eyelids had black burn marks.
Oh, my God.
Wow.
So they had closed before it had gone into my eyes, or I probably would have been blind.
Oh, my goodness.
And that same foreman again, you know, I didn't go off on compensation or anything. They put some salve on it. You know, go back to work. And that same foreman, he was infuriated. You know, he said, you're accident prone. I told you and told you and told you. You have put your tongs into the water along with the steel, and then put the tongs back into the cyanide. And that's why it blew up. Well, you know, I didn't know what the hell. I know I hadn't done that. And I told him very clearly I hadn't done that. But he was, you know, just convinced that I'd screwed up.
Oh, wow.
And Jack Eggie, the blacksmith, a few days later, it was raining, and he was thinking, and he went over, and he had a look, and the charcoal in the forge was wet.
Oh,
and
wow.
He looked up, there was a hole in the roof that had developed, and it had come right down into the pot of cyanide. So he went and told the foreman, you know.
You were exonerated.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He said, the foreman, you know, I told him clearly he was wrong and you were right.
Yeah.
So there's just a little bit of history of the dangers. Mm-hmm.
What would you have been hardening that steel for?
Well, Webb & Giffords had developed what they call a shingle machine, and they have a patent on it, and the patent is still registered. I looked it up, and it's under the American Patent Association.
Mm-hmm.
And they... this machine would do is you could feed shingles in it, and it went through a series of rollers and beaters, and it would cut grooves in it.
Mm-hmm.
And some of the older homes in New West maybe still have it. It's groove shingles. It's a fancy pattern.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
A lot of the equipment had pawls and other... processes where they, just like a clock, they open and move back and forth, and they were on pindles,
mm-hmm.
steel pindles, and it would be the end of those steel pindles that I would be hardening,
mm-hmm.
and they were drilled first, actually, the whole process, because I did the whole process. You would take these pindles, you would drill a hole through them, you'd put a grease fitting on the outside, and then you'd turn them at approximately 60 degree angle, and then you would harden the ends of them, and then they would work, you know, for many years, guiding this assembly. It was like old clockwork.
At the time you were apprenticing,
yes,
until you left, What was the majority of the business that Weapon Gifford was working on?
Good Lord, it was everything. I'll tell you one story. I'll tell you another story that I think within the first 3 months, I was given a job, and they were aircraft engine cylinders that came in from Sea Island. It's just slipped my memory right now what engines they came out of, but they were aircraft, piston-driven aircraft engines. And the cylinders, when they're under repairing the engines, the cylinders can be lifted or pulled right out. And then they have to be honed to get to break the glaze, and you get a crisscross of honing scores up and down on the cylinder. And also you can hone out the taper that's worn into them, so it makes them true again. And it has, you have to change your stones, and the stones work up inside of it, up and down, up and down. And you had this lapping compound, which you mixed up, you know, a very, very fine grinding compound, and you fed into the machine, and you did all this, and you mic'd it and got them square and got them properly honed, and then you washed them. You had to get all this lapping compound because it's hazardous to go back into an engine.
Mm-hmm.
Get them as clean as you could, and then you covered them with grease and then wrapped them in paper and put them in cases, and they were ready to go back. Bristol Aero Engines, mm-hmm. I think that was the name of it. And then a case after case was made ready to go back to Sea Island. So that day, either the truck driver was sick or whatever, and they wanted them back there. So they loaded up the truck and they asked me to take them down to Bristol Aero Engines and deliver them. And they said, "And whatever you do, do not say you have done that, the job on them. Because we have, a contract that only a journeyman machinist will do this work. And we'll be at, supreme risk if you, say, and I did the job."
Did any planes crash?
I don't think so, because I was very conscientious. They may have crashed very well, but not because of the job I did honing the aircraft cylinders. Yeah, so a list. Let's see if I could go through a bit of a list. Actually, it was a hard scrabble machine shop. And I was told when I started there, the history, bits and pieces of it came through to me, but the history was it had been that Jim Gifford had started it, and his expertise was a blacksmith, not a machinist, but he owned the shop, and then he developed it with the demand with a few lathes. And I understand that that old Lincoln welder that I used to haul around to the various job sites, it was a gas-driven Lincoln welder, at one point had been hauled as far as Chilliwack to do some welding, portable welding. And I find it really is an interesting point in history that it would have been so unique that Webb & Giffords had a portable electric welder when these little buzz boxes are in people's basements today.
Right.
They probably evolved to the point where in 1939, when the war started, Heaps Waterers, which you're familiar with down on Little Island, was a machine shop, and they geared up for the war effort, and then Webb and Giffords, and there was a couple of other machine shops, and they were given federal money to go out and buy upscale machining equipment, and they had, when I started there, they still had that equipment, a huge long, 40-foot long lathes, and I said, why did they need a lathe that big in there? They said, well, they used to do gun barrels with it. And they used to do a lot of the requirement, I guess, of certain machining for Second World War. Everything, as you know, had focused on the war effort.
Mm-hmm.
And
are you talking about Heaps or Webb and Giffords?
No, Webb and Giffords.
Yeah, okay.
You know, I think they may have gone into Heaps first because it was a little bit bigger machine shop.
Okay.
But then I'm sure that they focused. Then I know they focused on Webb and Giffords. Mm-hmm. And they got a huge air hammer, forging hammer, and they had a lot of equipment in there that was bought and placed in Webb and Giffords. And they had a number of people that worked in there that were called machine operators. They weren't machinists.
Mm-hmm.
And they were specifically to do one thing, and they run a milling machine or run a lathe or whatever. After the war, that was phased out, and we gradually worked towards just having, you know, journeyman, machinist, or blacksmith. Right.
So the difference between a machine operator and a machinist was the machine operator operated a specific kind of machine and was skilled in that machine?
Skilled in that machine.
Okay. And whereas the machinist...
You see, if you look on that certificate, they're trying to, I think that is, does it not define some of the equipment that I've been trained on? I think it does. And maybe it doesn't, maybe it's another piece out of...
Is one for a specific type of trade?
Yeah, it doesn't say that here, but I have other certification that says, you know, this gentleman has been trained on lathes, milling machines, drill presses, shapers, planers. In other words, you're well-rounded on all the equipment.
Oh, okay.
And so that, so the history of how Webb and Giffords kind of evolved from a small little shop and this huge jump for the war effort. Then after the war, I don't think they were required to buy the equipment back. I think it was just left with them.
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, like a lot of industry, they were going through a huge evolution of trying to find other work after the war, a bit of a slump.
Right.
All these contracts are suddenly stopped. And of course, their natural attribute was they were right on the river, so they had the shipping traffic going by. Mm-hmm. Now, Fraser Mills, which was the biggest sawmill in the British Empire,
right,
at one point at any rate, and was incorporated as the village of Fraser Mills, it had actual deep sea ships that came right up and docked at Fraser Mills. So if those ships required repairs, and quite often they did,
mm-hmm.
then Webb and Giffords saw, they hired some people that had some marine experience, and we would jump in and be doing marine repairs.
Right.
The Fraser Mills, which was Canadian Forest Products, after the Second World War, bought two huge tugs and eventually a third tug. They were U.S. Navy tugs.
Oh, wow.
And that was the Mary Mackin and the Florence Philbrough. And the Mary Mackin, in those days, it had horrendous engines. It had it was twin-screwed, 680 horsepower Fairbanks Morris engines. And Florence Philbrough had two 600 horsepower twin screwed. These were diesel engines, and they needed to be retrofitted from U.S. Navy tugs to coastal duties here.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of that retrofitting was done right down there at Webb and Giffords, so alongside the dock. And then later they bought the Isabel Stewart. I think she was steel hulled. Though they were wooden hulled, beautiful vessels. And the Isabel Stewart was single screwed, 900 horsepower.
Mm-hmm.
I think probably Fairbanks Morris too. And so we did some repairs on those vessels. Then what was evolving as I came on board in the machine shop, and I'm just talking about their marine link,
mm-hmm.
was New West was trying more and more to develop a port for tramp steamers.
Mm.
Now, during the Second World War, Kaiser, Henry Kaiser, became famous for building Liberty ships. And that was where the Americans in their assembly line process learned how to assembly line 10,000-ton freighters. And they did an amazing job on it. And they were just building bottoms to get goods over to Great Britain. And they put out thousands of them. We did, of course, a dry dock, but they were port-class vessels. These were Liberty vessels that I'm talking about. So not going too far down that line. After the Second World War, these Liberty ships were sold, and a lot of the Greek shipping and others, mainly Greek, they bought up thousands of them.
Oh, wow.
And these 10,000-ton freighters were tramping around the world looking for cargoes, and they were up here to New West, and they were being loaded with lumber.
Mm-hmm.
Now, it was really very unique in that you'd see the longshoremen, and they would be working down in the holds. You'd have your deck, your tween deck, and your hold. And they would, the first loads of this beautiful fir lumber, and it wouldn't be plain lumber because it was going overseas and they could cut it in what dimension and plane it there.
Right.
It would be, you know, this wide and this thick, and these 20 feet long, these beautiful
wow.
fir planks, and they were very heavy. And the longshoremen in those days would be right down in the hold, and you would have two booms coming off steam winches and cables. And this boom, if this was the vessel, one boom would be swung from the side of the vessel
mm-hmm.
to the midships, and the other boom would be the swing boom. There'd be 2 inches here, one in here. And the swing boom would heel out, and then it could pick up a load of lumber off the dock, bring it up, and then this one would start to haul it in, and it would swing the other boom, and they could swing them together and lower it down into the hold.
Okay.
Now, these longshoremen in the base of the hold, they would stand back to the edge, you know, as this lumber came down, and then these huge pile of lumber, they would hand bomb it, as we used to say, and they would lift these piles of lumber because they had to get it up under. From the hatch opening, they
right.
had to get it back right against the side of the ship, and they would put battens in between and shifting boards in between because the ship heeling, when it got into big seas going across the Pacific, it had to be loaded so it wouldn't ship cargo.
Mm-hmm.
So they would be working there doing all that work, and then once up in the tween decks, they had to run it down and try and get it swinging and then swing the load in under the tween decks and then offload from there and stack. Well, very dangerous job. There was the Canadian Shipping, I think, Corporation in Vancouver. It had inspectors. One eventually became a friend of mine, Captain Dick Wilson, and they had been officers in the Navy during
mm-hmm.
the Second World War, and then had shifted into this various occupations. And this occupation was to inspect the safety of the lifting gear on board ship. And these Liberty ships would come in from, say, they'd been to the Orient, and then they'd come over here, and they'd steam up the Fraser River and dock. And amazingly enough, they always had a piece of paper that said that all their lifting equipment had been inspected and was safe, somewhere signed off in the Orient.
Right.
And Dick Wilson, you know, would go down on board, him and another cohort, and they'd say, all right, when you did this testing of the equipment, you had to attach a plate
mm-hmm.
and an up-to-date stamp, and it was a copper plate, which was pinned into the heel of the boom, and the date and the whole, it's been safe, a working load tested for 3 tons or whatever.
Yeah.
And, they were sold a line of goods because, you know, the captain thought, yeah, that he could get away with just the paperwork.
Oh, wow.
And there would be Dick looking at the heat of the boom and he'd say, that paint hasn't been off there for 5 years
oh,
or
my
for
God.
10 years.
Yeah.
So the Longshoremen's Union was very strict on this. Unless they had a lifting apparatus certification that was approved by our inspectors on the West Coast here in Vancouver and New Westminster, they could not load lumber.
Oh,
wow. So now they would, wow, what are we going to do? We're sitting down here on the dockside and we can't load our cargo. So then Webb and Giffords would have a representative go on board and say, we're prepared to bring your ship up to standards for loading. And then the booms would be lowered, the heel pins would be lifted, the running blocks, the tackle, and all that equipment would be taken down, and the pins would be taken out, and what we would do, take some of this equipment back to the machine shop, and we had strain, we had equipment where we could put a certain ton of strain on it, and then hit it with a hammer and test it to see if it was going to fail. And in a great many cases, we could see it was going to fail. We wouldn't even have to test it. So then we would machine new pins. In some cases where there were chains, there was new chains. And the winches themselves, some of the bearings on the winches were defective. We would pour new bearings in the winches. So it was a huge job because you had four hatches. You had 2 inches for each hatch. You had all that running gear, all those pins, and even the wooden blocks. We even got new wooden blocks. In some cases, we drove out the pins, put in new pins. So without going too much further into it, it was a huge job.
Yeah.
And then, our reputation certainly went out to the point that we were doing ships in Vancouver. We were doing ships over in Burrard Docks and other places. And when a ship came in and wanted to lift cargo and then was refused because of this, time was of the essence because they were losing, demurrage charges for being tied to the dock. And so the heat would come on, and I've worked 24, 26, 28 hours straight, with just meal breaks.
Wow.
And
was there a sense of adrenaline during days like that where you were kind of racing against time to get these?
There would be a sense of adrenaline probably by the foreman, a sense of drudgery.
Because
some of the jobs we got into were just horrendously dirty.
Oh,
and,
man.
Like in one case, there was something wrong in a galley there, and I got up with maybe a vent fan or something wasn't working, and I had to get a cutting torch and cut the metal out to be able to get at it, and as the metal flopped down, there must have been 5,000 cockroaches came out, just like an army of cockroaches. these ships, I don't know if you've heard the term, but it's flag of convenience.
No, I haven't.
Well, it's even to this day, you see, if you are flying the Canadian flag on your ship, under Canadian ownership, your ship has to meet Canadian Marine standards. If you get the ship registered in Liberia, Monrovia, or any of those countries, third world countries, they'll give you the paper, they'll register you without even coming down on board. It's just payola. So when that ship sails into the dock here, it's Greek ownership, but it's registered in Monrovia, and it has no standards.
Mm-hmm.
And they were terribly unsafe. And so we applied the standards. That's why we applied the standards to the shifting gear and the loading gear. But, and the engines, the steam pipes, we replaced steam pipes. I could go on, unfortunately, for too long for you, but there was some fascination. There was a ship came in here one day, tied up on the dock down there near the foot of 8th, and we went on board, and I went up the gangway, the wooden gang plank, and my God, there was a guy with a looked pretty big to me, with a big rifle standing there, and he had white putties on to here, and a naval little hat and a blue uniform, and he was holding the gun out like that, and what is your reason for coming on board?
My.
Well, I'm not coming on board a naval ship. I'm coming on board a merchant ship. I'm thinking, what is this all about? It turns out that Cuba did not have merchant ships. It was a Cuban vessel. In that their ships that carried any merchandise for their requirement just had Navy personnel on board, so they had guns.
Oh my gosh!
And so there was quite a flavor on the U.S. waterfront in terms of ships from all over the world, mainly 10,000 ton freighters, mainly freighters in very poor repair. Another time I can remember, this ship was tied up right outside of Webb and Giffords, and it was Japanese, and I don't think we'd done repairs on that ship, but I was working in the machine shop that day, and I thought, holy God, somebody's killing themselves out there. And I ran out on the dock. I thought, you know, this is a hell of a Donnybrook going on in this ship. It wasn't at all. It's the way the Japanese culture. After the longshoremen had left, like, you not only filled the holds, they had deckloads of lumber, and some of these deckloads were as high as this ceiling. And they had to be all chained down, so they were eye bolts in the deck, say, on this side, and then a chain would go over this big amount of lumber, and then it would be hove through another ring and through another ring, and then they'd hook onto it with a steam winch and pull it tight and then pin it off. Well, it must have been 20 Chinese sailors running. After the longshoremen leave, the ship goes back to the crew because there's no interfacing in between. The crew cannot run the winches when the longshoremen are on board. But the longshoremen had left, and they were trying to meet the tide to get downriver, and that's where pressure really comes on,
right,
and get the deck cargo hove down tight. And this was the way the Japanese speak to each other, you know? Hi, he, ho, ho, you know? They were cracking out orders, you know? We could hear them inside the machine shop, and it sounded like, you know, a bunch of kung fu going on.
Oh,
there.
My gosh.
But,
and would the sailors have, did you have much interaction with sailors from
sorts
of places?
Oh, Lord, yes. I can remember once working overtime, and probably about 18 hours on a Swedish ship. It was about 4 o'clock in the morning. I was dead dog tired, and a couple of the machinists had gone into the galley and sat down, and they were having a glass that looked like apple juice, about that color.
Yeah.
And that full. Anyway, I came in, and, you know, nobody's gonna bother with the apprentice if he's stupid enough to stand out there, you know, to ask me in. So I wandered in and sat down, and one of these Swedes said, with a bit of a smile and a heavy accent, would you like one of those, lads? And I said, yeah, whatever the hell it is, I'm thirsty. And he shoved it over. God, it was straight whiskey.
Oh, my goodness.
You know, those Norwegians, straight whiskey to those Norwegian sailors was just the way you drank it. Good Lord, I just about... just about gagged on it, but you know, once it was poured, I got it down.
Yeah, as you do. Yes.
Yeah, and the other thing I found out is that whereas they have a huge tolerance for it, you know, I had very little. There was a lot of welding went on too. Like, there was steel ladders going down in the hold. The hold's about 40 foot deep, and quite often I'd be assigned to the welder too, to haul all these cables from our portable welder from the dock side up over the side of the ship, and then across, and then down into the hold, and it would be darker than hell. And then I'd rig what's called cluster lighting in those days, big lights like this with about 4 or 5 bulbs inside of them, and a reflector this big around, quite heavy, and haul all this equipment down and plug it in and lower it down into the hold so the welder could come down there and see what he was doing. And this day, this welder was saying, I'm anxious to get going, and I hadn't got the cluster light down, and he went down the ladder like this into this black hold, and then I heard this blood-curdling scream, and I finally got the cluster light over and hung it down the hold and looked down there. And he was laying on the bottom of the hold.
Oh, no.
And so anyway, I got the rest of the cables and got down there, and I said, what happened? And he says, well, he says, I found out why they wanted the, you know, the ladder repaired, or I found out where they wanted it. And I guess it was the last four rungs from the bottom, like about 5 foot from the bottom.
Oh, geez.
But when he slipped and fell, he had no idea
how far it was
going to be. How far it was going to be, and that's why I gave him blood-curdling scream. Another time he was working over the side of the hold, safety was just, like I say, it was not good. And he was on the end of this plank, which he'd rigged, and the plank was 5 foot out over the edge of the hold, and he was out there, and to counteract it, the plank went back about 15 feet, and he told me, sit on the end of it, and then he climbed out on the short end, and he's welding out there, and it's again about 4 o'clock in the morning, and I guess I nodded off and I started to fall off the end of the tank and he was going down.
Oh my goodness.
So anyway, we did ships. We did Leckie's Tannery across here.
Oh, yeah.
It was the leather tannery.
Mm-hmm.
Oh.
What did they need your services for?
Well, all the rollers for squeezing, pressing.
Oh, I see.
It was a lot of, there's a lot of machinery in a tannery for squeezing the tannic acid out of the hides and stretching them. And, it stunk to high heaven, you know, because...
The longshoremen said the same thing about unloading skins and stuff.
They did
said
they?
That was the worst job.
Oh, God. Because you see, when the green hides go in there, they still have fat and you know, and then the fat has turned rancid.
Right.
Because they've been in shipment for quite a while. And then sometimes the tanning was done where the hair was taken off, sometimes where it wasn't. But when they go through this scraping machinery to get all this guts off, you know, the guts would go into slop buckets and it would still be sitting. And I guess they got desensitized to it.
They must have.
But
yeah.
Boy, when we went in to either take this machinery out to take it back to the shop or to work on it there, it was god awful. Then we did the tenor. We did Columbia newspaper here. Now, that was lead typeset even then, and there was a huge amount of rollers and conveyors. You've seen what the old newspapers. So a lot of those machines would have to be set, leveled. It was very critical to the leveling and balancing of the rollers. If they were a little bit one way or the other, the paper would fly off.
Oh, wow.
So they had to be almost very precise in how they were set up. So we machine rollers, we went down there, installed, did repairs. We did, of course, a raft of sawmills right from Burrard Inlet, Bestwoods on Burrard Inlet, and Flavel Cedar. We did Redwood, the Macmillan Bloedel Red Band Division down there on the Fraser. We did, we actually built a little steam engine for the back and blow for splitting shake bolts. And we machined and made, you name it, we did it. And then one day, this guy walked into our machine shop and said, I have a contract to build display equipment for Woodward's in Vancouver. Woodward's were famous at Christmas time for their window displays. And their window displays, of course, were not as they would be today, which would be a little computer chip and a program. They were mechanical, and they hid the tracks, but there was little tracks there and poles and wheels and the whole business. Well, he had this.
That was a tour happening upstairs.
Oh,
and,
wow.
And he had
he had
a new. Invention for display equipment, which he'd sold to Woodward's, and he came into the machine shop and wanted us to make it, and so we made that. We made playground equipment for in New Westminster, the jungle gyms and the slides and
for the city parks.
Okay. We repaired and made winches for tow vehicles. We made equipment for and then in the forest industry was just evolving in the early 50s up into the interior with the lodgepole pine.
Mm-hmm.
You know, up until then, the prime wood products off this coast was the coastal fir, spruce, and so on and so forth. But all of a sudden, they found markets for the pine, and the race was on, and it was green gold. And what they would do with that is they'd go right out into where they had these timber claims with portable sawmills, cut the tree down, flip it onto the deck, and start cutting right there, because it was small wood.
Mm-hmm.
So it was, they were able to do that. So Webb & Giffords, being on the edge of this again, made portable sawmills on tires. And the two ends would fold up. They were 60 feet long, and they'd be 40 with the two ends folded up. And they, once they got on site, they would hook up an old gas engine to it and drive it with belts. But it had a live carriage and a big head saw. And so we made sawmills, and then we made small planers, and we made edgers. Planers, edgers, sawmills, and various and sundry other equipment. Then we made the blacksmith shop for the logging industry. When a bulldozer is yarding a large log, they have what is called a bull hook, and it's a big hook, you know, about this big.
Right, yeah.
And then all the chokers hook into this bull hook.
Uh-huh.
So we forged and made these big bull hooks out of SBS 245 special alloyed carbon steel. And then we made picaroons in a sawmill. When you want to flip, you have a big cedar log coming up a slipway, and then a head saw comes down, and they keep cutting it like that, just like cutting, mm-hmm. you know, sausage. Well, they'd be cut in the proper length for shingles, or in some cases, shakes.
Mm.
And then another guy on the other side of the, after they were cut, he'd hit it with a sharp, I should have brought one in, I still kept one for the machine shop. He'd hit it with something like an axe, but it just had a pick on the end of it, and he'd flip it. And then that block, which was that way, would be this way,
okay.
and then it would move along a little bit. And then that steam engine that we had built, they would pull a lever, and this tri-axe would come down, just a splitter axe, and
yeah.
boom. And now you had your four bolts for the shingle sawyer.
Right.
So
is Webb & Giffords quite innovative then?
Extremely
innovative. You've mentioned a couple of things where they've been adapting to, it seems like, a
yes.
change in the industry or a change in technology.
Change in the industry, change in the technology, and they were always scraping and scratching to come up with something new because the United States was tooling up too, and we were competing with them. And I guess they didn't make it, though. They went into receivership, and so did the one. There was a machine shop, and I can't think of the name of it, just on the corner of Columbia and Brunette by Lucky Lager Brewery.
That wasn't Vulcan, was it?
No.
That was
in that corner, there was Lucky Lager Brewery, and then there was this machine shop. And then there was Westminster Boiler and Tank. They did some... and. Durant Machine Works.
Mm-hmm.
They were just down there by Westminster Boiler and Tank.
Yeah.
So a lot of these machine shops just went under. They just couldn't evolve. I think probably what really happened is, I think I know what happened, and I hadn't thought of it before, but you see, they were building one-off, very custom machining.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas down in the United States and other places, they were starting to go into really assembly line production, high-speed production, and they could flood the market with stuff that was... They hadn't got into CNC, it's called a computer something or other machining.
Mm-hmm.
Like nowadays, a machinist, maybe a designer will write a program,
mm-hmm.
and the program will come down in disc form, just like an embroidery sewing machine.
Yeah, yeah.
Now come down in disc form, and he has to know the proper material to load. He has to cut it the right length. But once he puts it, puts in his program, boom, 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 and it's all automatic. And where is you're paying machine shop time $100, $120 an hour now?
Mm-hmm.
For a one-off, it just becomes too expensive. So
mm-hmm.
I think It was the automation of the machining industry that put these small custom machine shops, even though they were scrambling, in the end, they couldn't make it. Second thing that happened, I told you the story about the welder going out to Chilliwack. Well, you know, welders and little machine shops were now going into the sawmills for their own. And then millwrights were not so much in vogue to start with. But as the machine shops came into play in the little sawmills, millwrights were being trained to do, you know, they were kind of a jack of all trades. They could do a little welding, a little machining, a little of this, a little of that. And so the phones would stop ringing for Webb and Giffords because these people were doing their own, and understandably so. So, and it's still evolving. I mean, it's evolving now where China, of course, is flooding the machine industry of North America with cheap machines, lathes, drill presses, and now it's evolved not only from the sawmills, it's evolving right into people's garages in their backyards where they're doing their own little fiddle.
Yeah.
And it, I guess it was a very good question because it triggered, yes, it was the evolution of the, because we talk about automation, we think, like maybe you think of it differently, but we think of it, you know, the Henry Ford. And the advent of automation in North America with the automobile, and how in the, eventually he was building automobiles. He started building Model Ts at $900 a unit and ended up building them for $300 a unit because he evolved even his automation process to a finer art.
The larger companies put out the little companies.
That's right.
My dad had his own mills.
Yeah, his own sawmill, yeah.
Put out of business.
Put out of business, yeah. Mm-hmm. So,
it is.
And Westminster's waterfront was, you know, alive with deep sea ships, sailors. They all came ashore, you know. And during the Second World War, we had naval vessels in here, smaller ones, and we had the minesweepers and other smaller vessels. Minesweepers were wooden hull vessels in those days. And it was very much a marine port, very much alive with an international flavor of sailors. The towboat industry, of course, I've told you about that. I told you about the Mary Mack and the Florence Pilgrim.
Right.
But, you know, like the one that I used to admire so much was called the SS Sea Lion. SS stands for steamship. And she was one of the last that came up the river, still a working tugboat that was a steam engine. And she would have been a triple expansion steam engine, probably in the neighborhood of 900, 1,000 horsepower. And she had a whistle, a steam whistle, and they had tuned her so it didn't just blow, it blew a tune.
Okay.
And she was known all over the coast because she would go, and you know, I could hear that in the machine shop, and I run out on the dock, and she was painted to the nines. She was just a glorious vessel, about 110 feet long, wood, and if she pulled it into our dock, they on these old tugs, they had Dutch doors, wooden made Dutch doors, so they would swing open the top of the Dutch door, and as they docked, and this cook would lean over the edge, you know, and he'd look up at me on the dock, or look up, and he had one of those high white hats of the old-fashioned cooks.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and he'd be in full white, and they would have had, just to give you an example, they would have had two firemen, because they were probably still firing coal.
Right.
Because the conversion, the steamers that stayed on converted to burning diesel fuel in their boiler. But I believe, because the black smoke, I can still remember, it's a good indicator, she was still burning coal. So they'd have had two firemen. They would have had two engineers, at least. Then they would have had two mates and a skipper.
Mm-hmm.
then they would have had 4 or 5 seamen. So they would have had on that tug, but 10 to 12.
Oh, yeah.
Now, and they would have been maybe 1,000 horsepower. Today, we have tugs on this coast to 20, oh, even higher than that, but 2,500 horsepower, and they don't have more than 4 on board. Yeah, things have evolved so fast.
Did you ever work on the Samson 5?
No, I didn't. Although I did apply. And she was steam.
Yeah.
And I used to see her up the Pitt River pulling snags and see her come down here. And I applied, you know, a marine engineer was quite often didn't stay on one ship, moved around.
Mm-hmm.
I applied and just missed getting the job on the whalers that were at that time going off the foot of Main Street and going out and shooting whales. And I'm glad that I didn't get that job. They were pulling them into Cold Harbor up in top end of Vancouver Island.
Did they?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. It was a big whaling station there.
Oh.
Did you ever do any work on the Samson 5 through Webb and Gifford?
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
What sort of stuff did they need to have repairs done for?
Oh, just minimal stuff. Some lifting gear we did. But, it, you know, it would just be... they had a lathe on board, I think, you know.
Yep.
And they had a little machine capacity, but yeah, we did a little bit of fabrication for them. Now, another thing, moving down this dockside, you know, you've recorded that terminal docks were down there.
What is now
Pacific Coast Terminal Docks,
yeah.
CPR. And we used to get a lot of lead coming down from trails by railway, and they'd be offloaded there, and they had to spread it around because if they loaded all these lead in one spot, they could go right through the dockside. And for some reason, they were rigged. The pallets they came in on were rigged with eye holes on the four corners. And then there was a lifting bridle of four chains that came to a center ring.
Uh-huh.
And they would load deep sea ships with these. And those chains, those lifting chains, could only be used for so long. And then they would have, because when you stress iron, it becomes the atomic crystals, or structure of the iron changes as strain after strain comes on board, and they become brittle and weaken through the brittleness of the process, especially if there's more carbon in the steel. It tends to work harden, is what it's called.
Right.
And so after a year or two in service, those chains had to be taken out of production. We'd go down, load them up, take them back to Webb and Giffords, and then we had big blast furnace, and then they'd be loaded into the blast furnace, and this was a light fuel oil fired blast furnace. Heat them up until we would get them glowing cherry red.
Okay.
And then just hook them with a, you know, a long steel hook. Just pull them out right onto the concrete floor and just let them air chill.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, so you had to anneal them?
Yeah, anneal them.
Okay.
And then once they were annealed, they would have scale on them, of course, by then because they've been heated. And then we would take them to our strain testing machine and hook up on one end, hook up on the other, put... most of them in those days were three, safe working load was 3 tons, so we would be doing 3 times that. We'd be doing a 9-ton stretch, and we'd hook on, we had a hydraulic gauge, and put 9 tons on it. Then once we had 9 tons on it, then we would take a hammer. Oh, we used to wonder about this process. And we'd go along and we'd hit it like a, you know, boing, boing, and the scale would fly off, boing, boing. And if nothing flew apart, and then you would inspect it. You had to get the scale off. Because these chain links were not welded in those days. Because welding was not considered a safe process. There was a wedge, the link was forged, and a wedge made on the link. The two wedges came like that, and they were blacksmith welded. They were hammer forged. You would get them up almost to white hot, and then slide them under the hammer, and then you would put... was called Swedish steel or something. It was a gray powder. heat them up white hot, put this powder on it quickly, put it down, put it on it, and then hammer it. And then it would actually weld itself together.
Oh, wow.
And then again, that would be tested. So anyone that showed any propensity for this weld coming apart, it would be cast aside, opened up, re-welded, and then it would be eventually stamped, and I used this hand stamp, safe working load, SWL, 3-ton. And then these chains would go back to the terminal dock.
I wanted to ask about the relationship between the journeyman and the apprentices.
Yes.
What was that like? What was the experience, I guess, of moving towards that journeyman status?
That's what I love about the young, well-educated. They ask such great questions. of course, it varied.
Yeah.
There was those that were egotistically inclined to, you'll never reach my level, and I'm going to make sure you don't. Mm. I'm not going to give you my innermost secrets.
Uh-huh.
To those that took you under their arm and tried very hard to bring you along. I shouldn't tell you this story, but I will. Anyway. Yeah.
Sounds like a good one.
it's not a good story, but I, as a young person growing up, I detested bullies. And I was a small kid.
Mm-hmm.
And I learned how to deal with bullies. And I held my own because they pushed me too far.
Yeah.
I'd flip. And this welder, who I had many, many times worked with in the haul of cables, and you know, I tried very hard to be there for him. He was Swedish extraction and just had a bit of an attitude where he was going to treat me like I was, you know, not well. And this one day I was working on the ship and I was told, go back and get the welder to check out the welding machine, that all the cables and everything are there that we need, and bring it back. So I jumped in the truck and I went back and I said to the welder, who was working in the corner there, would you check out the welding machine? Because I got to take it back, and the other welder on the ship wants to make sure that he's got everything he requires on it. So he didn't answer me, and I went out in the blacksmith shop and talked to the blacksmith there, and this was in the evening, you know, we're tired and we're stressed, and I'm talking to the blacksmith, and he came out into the blacksmith shop, and he had a greasy old rag, and I guess it had welding chips in it or whatever, and he said, it's ready. And he threw it right in my face, and then I got all this scale and crap in my eyes. And I just took one step forward, and I came up with an uppercut. And I swung so hard, and I was so mad, you know, that he stepped back, and I missed him.
Oh, no.
But what I didn't realize, he had in his hand a chipping hammer, you know, for chipping scale, a sharp-pointed chipping hammer. And he came down and tried to hit me across the side of the head with it as hard as he could swing, and I ducked back, and I said, you bastard, I said, you want to use tools, I'll use tools. And I got behind me and I got a sledgehammer and I picked it up, and he took off out of the blacksmith shop onto the railway tracks, which are right there on Front Street.
Yeah.
And he started down the he was about 40 or 45, and, you know, I never seen a guy run so fast. He started off down the railway tracks heading towards New West, and me behind him with a sledgehammer.
Oh, my goodness.
And he was taking 15-foot jumps. Luckily, you know, I ran about half a block until I, you know, my adrenaline rush had left. And
the sledgehammer was probably heavy.
Yeah, that's right. And the sledgehammer was slowing me down. And it wasn't that I needed a tool that big. It was just that it was there.
Yeah.
And I came back to the blacksmith shop and I thought, you know, the rule is if you fight, you're fired.
Yeah.
And so I came back into the blacksmith shop. And the next morning, I came in and the foreman said to me, well, you should be fired, and I would have fired, but the blacksmith said, you know, that he had started. So that's the end of it. But
did the other guy get fired?
No.
Oh, okay.
So there were rules of conduct, it seems like, between conflict and and men sorting things out amongst themselves sort of thing as well.
But he stayed the hell away from me after that. You know?
Wow.
And that's, you know, that's the bully, you know. Mm-hmm. Once a bully realizes he could be, or they could be at risk, they back off.
Mm-hmm.
What was the work distribution determined between what a blacksmith would do, a machinist would do, and a welder might do?
That's a very good question. Again, a machinist, you know, they consider themselves to have exacting skills. They could work within a thousandth of an inch.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. They would make bits sometimes that were so exacting that you had to, if you were putting a sleeve onto a drive piece of equipment that was going to go under great stress, you may take the center core of the steel and pack it in dry ice to shrink it, and then take the collar you're putting in and just get it red hot, but heat it to maybe blue heat. Blue heat's above 700 degrees. Blue heat it, and then boom, and then when it comes together, it's going to hold. So those type of fits, you know, require some pretty damn good machining, and, you know, they consider themselves kind of highly skilled in that regard, and they were. But even under the machinists, they were sorted. There was one machinist who was most skilled in the shop. Nobody could, everybody knew that. He just, you know, he had a great gift.
Mm-hmm.
And he could do designing too. And then there was those that were giving repetitive work of drilling holes in plates. And, you know, but they all had their talents. And then there was the welders. Well, the welders were not considered to have the skill of the machinist. But they were very good, you know. As you know, a welder is... Does a lot of triangulation in the support of the welding structure he's putting together.
Mm-hmm.
So they don't have much background in physics, but they do understand by trial and error that you've got to have some triangulation or other gusseting or whatever. So, you know, I consider them very skilled. Mm-hmm. Welding on various materials, because they did bronze, they did brass. So they did ferrous and non-ferrous irons, and they clearly had to know the difference in how to do it. Then the blacksmith, he was a joy to behold. He grew up in his daddy's blacksmith in Saskatchewan, and then joined the Navy, became a fireman in the Navy, and came back out again and back into the blacksmith trade. And he was a machine blacksmith, mm-hmm. as opposed to a farrier. A lot of people today hear blacksmith and they think they're making shoes and doing horses.
Right.
But the machine blacksmith meant that he could bend huge pieces of iron and to for industrial use. Today, there's because it's very slow, there's different processes. But for instance, if you wanted to put a new steam pipe, high-pressure steam pipe, in an engine room, then you wouldn't weld the joints. They weren't considered as safe for high pressure. Today, of course, they are. Different technology. And you can use radiology to determine the strength of the weld.
Mm-hmm.
But then they were one pieces, and they, a 20-foot length of pipe, maybe this big, would be put upright in the blacksmith shop, and then a ladder up against it, braced a ladder up against it, and you poured buckets and buckets of the dry white sand down inside of it. And then you plugged, big wooden plugs were driven in either end, and then they were placed down with chain falls onto a bending table, big steel bending table. And then you got a rosebud, which is a huge heating torch, oxoacetylene heating torch. And then you would flame that pipe until you got it red hot, and then you'd use come-alongs and start to bend it around big bending pins, and then you would have your pre-made templates either off the old pipe that had been condemned or what you'd taken in the engine room to get the curves, and you would it was quite intricate, some of the bends. Wow. And this was heavy, heavy pressure steam pipe, you know, thick wall, Schedule 80 of steel, which is made for high pressure.
Seems like there was quite an identity to being a machinist and quite a pride in the work. And
very much so.
Yeah.
But of the 5 years apprenticeship, and now it's four, there was 1 year in the blacksmith shop. And I thought that was rather unique, and I loved it. Because it was 5 years night school, too, in machine shop theory down at what was then Vancouver Vocational School, which has now become Vancouver City College.
Mm-hmm.
And you did machine shop theory. And then at the end of the five-year apprenticeship, you did a government exam. And then you got certification.
Right.
So how long were you with Webb and Gifford for?
Just for the apprenticeship, full 5 years.
And then you moved on?
Yes. I moved, well, then I, it was a bad time. It was, you know, all John Diefenbaker's Avro Arrow crash and everything else came down together, and we were in a recession on the West Coast here, and especially the machine shops that were affected by it. And I had taken a tool and die course by then, too, and I was so fed up. I was thinking of going and joining the Boeing group down in Seattle, because machinists and tool and die makers, they needed them. And I went into the American Bureau in Vancouver. You know, I'm still a country kid, and I'm just, you know, going to go in there and apply. And my God, they were down the hallway for 40 feet and around the corner, lined up, you know, to just get the forms and start the process of getting a working visa down.
Right.
And I think I was in the lineup all for about 5 or 10 minutes, and said, the hell with it, I don't want to be an American. And then another place I applied was Kenworth Truck.
Oh, yeah.
And Kenworth were an American company, and at that time they had a division down close to Boundary and Low Heat Highway, down which is the Horn Pain Sub now, and I went in there and filled out their application to be a machinist. And I got to this point, and when I took it like that, I threw it in a waste paper basket.
Mm.
It said, "Are you now, or have you ever been, a member of the Communist Party?"
And had you?
No.
No. Oh, but, and because they were.
But it was the McCarthy era, and it was invasive. It was an American firm. They were in Canada, and they brought that bloody form right across the border.
Wow! And was that the only political question that had appeared on the form?
Yeah. Yeah.
That's interesting. Yeah.
So are you guys out of time, or are you?
No, but no.
I said it'd be close to an hour. We're closing on two now. This is great.
It's a really wonderful interview so far, actually. Well, I was going to ask you about your social life, and did you socialize with workers and stuff outside of work?
Not a lot. Yeah, with the apprentices. With one.
The young guys that you had sort of banded together?
Banded together, but not a lot, because one lived in Millardville, one lived in New West, and I was in Port Coquitlam.
Oh, right.
But, you know, that one machinist, which I said was just, I'm going to digress, but there one machinist, which I said, he had an odd personality, but I just so admired his skills.
Oh, right, yeah.
And the other thing I admired was he'd been a motorcycle racer.
Oh, wow.
And he'd been quite successful on the dirt tracks and on road racing. And his buddy that he'd raced with was Trev Dealey.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
The motorcycles.
Yeah. And so my 30 Dodge, it was bleeding me to death. You know, I'm working 2 o'clock in the morning still trying to get, you know, the thing running to go to work the next day. And this guy said he'd trade me for a motorcycle.
Oh.
Right across the board. And so I did, and it was my first motorcycle. And I went, It was one of those that you pedaled and then you dropped the clutch and it would start. No gears.
Oh, wow.
But it would do 55, you know, if not 60 going downhill if you leaned over. And I arrived at the machine shop and proudly said, I now have a motorcycle. In those days, you didn't need a license or hard hat or anything. And this machinist came out and looked at it and put his nose up and he said, well...
with pedals.
Yeah. I quickly traded that up and into a larger machine, and then I was always just picking his brain. And you know, I can remember asking him, how do you ever get the nerve to do 100 miles an hour on two wheels? And he said, well, you don't start overnight doing it. And secondly, when you fall off, you know, it's not like you're falling down a cliff. As long as you don't hit something, you slide for a while. I never forgot that answer. And so they were lucky. They would let me stay after. I was lucky. They'd let me stay after closing hours. And I started to machine little bits and pieces for my motorcycle.
Oh, wow.
So that was my big interest, and it seems that the other two apprentices were not into that. And so this machinist started to take more interest and started to tell me of how to race tune a motorcycle, until I was eventually racing motorcycles too. And,
oh wow!
It all came out of this little machine shop.
That's great.
Wow.
So I eventually aspired. And with the motorcycle that I tuned from his coaching and my machining skills at Robin Giffords, I won the Canadian National Championship modified racing class.
What year was that?
1956.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Oh, we done it.
Do you have the bike still?
Pardon me?
Do you have your bike still?
We both do,
we
yeah.
Both
do you?
Yeah, I just got my license a couple of years ago.
Oh, good for you.
Do you have the bike from the 50s?
No, I don't.
No.
I wish I had. Yeah.
Oh, wouldn't
yeah,
that
I
be something?
Had, yeah.
Do you have photos of it?
Yes.
Well, that's at least you have that.
Yeah.
He's
yes,
got the
I
leather,
do.
You know,
oh,
helmet and all
yeah,
that.
Yeah.
Wow.
That little machine shop just, you know, it did a lot of things for me. It taught me how to toughen up to the world without being bitter or cynical, and to it put my roots into the environmental movement, because you know, I realized just how the Fraser River had been treated as a receptacle for garbage, and it is an amazing salmon river, as you know. It's probably the largest in the world. At the Columbia was before we put a myriad of dams on it.
You're not going to tell me you work for BC Hydro?
yeah.
How long
yeah.
are you with them?
25 years.
Oh,
know.
So
wow.
is that, that's pretty much your
yes.
career then?
Yeah, that's what I, well, I retired from, when I finished Webb & Giffords, there was a lot of, as I said, I tried to get work, and a journeyman, the definition of a journeyman is that after you finish your apprenticeship, you journey.
Right.
And the concept being that maybe nobody's going to come out and tell you that, but you see, hiring an apprentice at 50 cents an hour, and immediately you're doing work that they're charging full journeyman rate for.
Right, like the planes.
That's right.
Yeah.
So they had three apprentices. They would have had more, but they only could have so many per journeyman under the apprenticeship trades training committee. So they had their max. They had three. Well, as soon as you finished your apprenticeship, you're, generally speaking, not going to be as skilled as a 15 or 20-year man.
Right.
15 years is a master man. So after the 5 years, you're kicked out the door, and another apprentice comes in at the other end.
I see.
And that, you know, that's a history that goes back into years and years and years. My grandfather was in a trade, and my great grandfather was a cord binder. I think that's a cord winder,
mm-hmm.
a shoemaker, And he was 7 years in his trade. And when he finished, he had on the side at night, he'd been making shoes and boots, just one off custom, and squirreling them away. And then he was 50 miles north of London. Our route story goes, he put them in a case and walked to London. And that was his certification of his trade. And so it's a long history that journeymen do travel. I was traveling from Webb and Giffords, and thank goodness I did, because, you know, they had gone. If I'd stayed there, as the other apprentices did, they would have followed it downhill into bankruptcy and had to look for other work. Mm-hmm. Whereas in the spring, I went back to Vancouver City College, and I started to study to be a marine engineer, and I didn't. A marine engineers on this coast had to work their way up through the engine room. You started as a oiler or as a helper in the engine room, and then gradually learned on the job. Then you went to college, and then you had to prove, you know, at least 2 years of engine room time, and it had to be certified too. You know, when you sign on a ship, the date you sign on to the date you sign off, you are attached to that vessel. Mm-hmm. And that means that you're, and then there's a book that stamp goes in. Well, you would have to have all those stamps certifying that you had that amount of time in the engine room before you could write the exam. Well, I didn't, because this was called Marine Engineers and Machinists, and I was able to satisfy them that we had worked on so many ships.
Right.
As that I qualified, and then I actually pushed and challenged the exam. I just went down there, and I also had a marine engineer who coached me and told me what to know and what library to buy in order to study.
Mm-hmm.
And then I went down there and challenged it and passed. And then I got a job for the CBR, Western Canadian Steamship Division, on their 15,000 horsepower Princess Patricia. She was a beautiful turbo electric in those days, and took off from there. And then eventually I wanted to come ashore in the 60s, and I went back to Vancouver City College and then took power engineering, and we put I did work to put in the first powerhouse up in Golden. Because Kicking Horse Forest Products were a big diesel genset, and they wanted to start using their hog fuel and burning it and producing steam and electricity. And so I was hired on there to supervise, along with five other engineers, to supervise the building of a powerhouse. Now, once we built it and we went online, we were one of the first cogens. We started generating electrical energy for Donald up the line, and for Golden, and then Parsons, and three or four little districts going down the line towards Cranbrook. And we were synchronized with BC Hydro, cogenning power. And it was from my experience there that I applied for BC Hydro, and then came down. And
that's neat.
Yeah.
So were you prompted to go into the marine engineering because you had enjoyed working on the ships the
absolutely,
most?
Absolutely, yes. Yeah, because, you know, I guess I was never really cut out to be a machinist. I love it, and but what I like is to machine something, go over there, fit it, make it run, climb on it, and ride away.
Yeah.
Yeah.
To, you know, it's the repetition. You got to be a watchmaker to be a good machinist. The repetition in front of a piece of machinery, it's just not my cup of tea. And you have to have an amazing power of concentration. You can't be distracted. And I'm easily distracted. I like people, and I like to interface with people, and I like to move. And,
And it seems like the scene on the ships was very much social, and you were talking about the energy.
Yes. Oh, good Lord. And we went to, I was on the cruise, after that I was on the cruise ships going to Alaska.
Oh, wow.
And, you know, then.
All over the place.
Yeah, and the White Pass Yukon Railway, you know, I got free passes on that. And was able to do things that a lot of people my age hadn't been able to do. Mm-hmm. It was just like Webb & Giffords was the key to the whole thing.
Wow.
And I won't say that I got the greatest training in the world, because they really did not hire me to adopt me to become a highly skilled machinist.
Mm-hmm.
They hired me because they thought I had enough attributes to assist them in turning out equipment that they could charge a journeyman rate while paying me $50, $75 an hour, and that I would be valuable to them. But at the end of the day, after 5 years, if I was a good machinist or not, they could care less, and they never ever indicated. I spent a lot of time when things were tight and they needed it, driving their truck in downtown Vancouver to pick up a certain piece of high carbon steel or a springs or to do this or do that. I once said every 6 months or every year they had the trades training apprentice from Victoria would stop in on the machine shop and talk to the foreman and then come and say to me, you know, and how do you think you're progressing, and do you have any issues? And I said, yeah, I have painted more pieces of machinery, driven the truck more times, you know, been down in the hole of a ship, scraping rust off some spot so a welder could weld. What the hell has that got to do with becoming a fine, highly skilled machinist? Well, lad, you have to learn to take some of that too.
But the owner liked you.
Yeah, the owner liked me.
That story you told me about what you were doing.
Oh, this is a hell of a story.
Oh, it's so cute.
Jim Gifford, he was a character. And when I look in the archives of it on Google, where the ancestry, Scotch ancestry, 1876, they came through parts of the United States, and then up here, Jim was born about 1890, maybe something like that. Wait, 1880. He was, you know, I consider him very old. He had an old, rumpled blue suit he wore most of the time, and a bowler hat of all things.
Oh, wow.
And he had a very, very pale face and a very wrinkled and a very gruff look about him. And he would come down once a day about 10 o'clock, and he'd wander through the machine shop and walking around like this, and out into the blacksmith shop, wander around like that, never say a damn word. And he looked so gruff and so, you know, like he was ready to fly off the handle. It's two stories. This one story is a beauty. We'd done a tow truck, and we put a winch on the back, and that's all we had done. But we had to hook it up to a power takeoff from his transmission, so we had to go under the truck, and we'd done all of that. And this one day, I see this guy, and I recognize him, and he's the owner of this truck, and he's in the foreman's office, and there's a yelling match going on. And he's yelling and shouting, and I'm kind of watching this. And then I overheard him say, you know, you bastard, you put a hole in my radiator and it's leaking, and, you know, I want, you know, compensation. And the foreman's saying, you know, we weren't even near your radiator. You know, this is ridiculous. And this guy suddenly flipped up. There's a steel pry bar. It's about this big, and it's about this high, and it's for shifting or prying things. It's quite heavy. You know, it weighs 20 pounds. I was leaning against the wall. Anyway, this guy ran out of the office, and he grabbed this steel shifting bar, and he turned around, and our truck had just come into the machine shop to offload some equipment, and he ran like that, and he ran it right through the radiator. And then he got a hold of the end of it.
Oh, my God.
And he had a hold of the radiator. Water and steamers just coming out from all over, a big cloud of steam. And Jim Gifford, and he used to, it sounds like this, Jim Gifford had just come out of the office and walking home. God, he looks at that. He grabs this bloody great steel bar, picks it up like that, and he literally took four big jumps, and he pinned the guy right against the wall like this.
Whoa!
Call the police! And he held him there. The guy couldn't move.
Wow.
Yeah, you see, Jim was, he was a star player on the Salmon Bellies.
Oh my God, yeah.
That was just our cross
check. Yeah, cross check.
Oh, wow. I had a hell of a lot more respect for Jim after that. And then the other story, just to make it quick, I was bad for making rabbits. We call them rabbits, and that's where, you know, during working time, you sometimes made something for yourself in between. And I was making a megaphone for my motorcycle. You know, it came down to exhaust pipe size and came out to about this size, this big. And on a racing motorcycle, a megaphone will induce the exhaust gases to come out quicker and the gas charge come in quicker. It gets it breathing better. And I couldn't afford to buy a megaphone. They were quite expensive. So we had some sheet metal there. And I had cut a pattern, and then I cut it out of this metal. And I was rolling it over the horn of the anvil just to get a nice shape. We were in between heats, and the blacksmith didn't need me right then. And so I was tapping this thing, and it was a little awkward and springing around. And all of a sudden, this hand came behind me, and I could see by his cuff, it was Jim Gifford. I'm bored. He came, and because he was a blacksmith, he just knew, you know, how to hold it and help me. And I daren't look behind me, and I was tapping and rolling, and we got it just straight. And he said, "There," and I said, "Yeah, it looks good." And off he went. I think he must have known, though, that this was not for a customer. Yeah.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. And they called that making rabbits? Like if you were making a rabbit. Like a code for whatever it was that you were doing?
Yeah, it was a home project, making a rabbit.
Making a rabbit.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. Where do you think that came from?
I don't know.
I've never heard the term before.
Yeah.
Did everyone sort of do it at one time or another? Would you, if they had a little spare time?
Everybody had their idiosyncrasies, I think. I remember one fellow who, I saw him do something, and he damn near cut his hand off, and I just thought he was inappropriate the way he had approached it. And one of the other machinists said to me, "What color?" That was his name. He said, he said, it was Jim McCullough, I think his name was. Anyway, he said, when you get here about 7:45 in the morning, have a look at him out in the parking lot. That's all he said. So I have a look. He was starting his morning with a Mickey.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
Wow.
He could down a whole Mickey.
So is Jim McCullough the machinist, or the guy that...
Machinist, yeah.
He was the one that told you to look at him in the parking lot, or was he the guy that was drinking?
Yeah, Jim McCullough was the guy that was drinking.
Oh, okay.
That something that happened? Was drinking a presence in the
That's interesting because it was a... I moonlighted in a garage too after hours, and a mechanic in there by 4:00 in the afternoon used to be hiring a kite too. And I, you know, I think we can probably all agree in this room that when people have a long, hard row of drudgery that goes on and on and on, there's not much light, not much joy in their life, that they're reaching out and seeking somewhere. They just, you know... You're getting older. You're getting arthritis. You don't have a pension plan.
You don't do anything for fun, or
you don't do anything
long
for
hours,
fun.
Yeah.
Long hours.
You don't have life.
I mean, look at Russia. My God, you know, their alcoholism in Russia is just outrageous.
Right.
Well, in Fraser Mills, it's the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
Yeah.
Same with projects that you were talking about. My brother and my dad both work there. Both my brothers and my dad.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
We are so lucky, the age that we live in now. I mean, we just... It's very easy to judge people, but oh my God, the drudgery, you know, in some of those jobs.
Absolutely.
How about the other shops that were adjacent and beside Webb and Gifford? Did you have much to do socializing across the different...
Augustine Cole was right next to us. Now, that was interesting in that they had coal brought in by the railroad.
Yeah.
And then Parker Quitlam transfer was one, because I lived in Parker Quitlam. I knew that. That's where Parker Quitlam got all their coal, which they sold to through their building and supply company. It was called Parker Quitlam Transfer. I think it's still called that. And most of the homes in Parker Quitlam in those days either had sawdust hoppers or they had coal for heat. Mm-hmm. And they would get it from Augustine Coal.
Okay.
And a truck would come in, and because I was in a machine shop, I'd see this many times. It was all hand-bombed. It was two sacks of coal, and they weighed 90 pounds, and it was over each shoulder.
Oh, geez.
You know, 180 pounds. And they'd go, and like they would get it here, and then they would back up to the truck and offload it onto a flatbed of the truck. They'd take a whole 5-ton truckload of coal, which was all hand-loaded, and they did it, you know, day after day after day to supply the homes of Parker Quitlam.
Yeah.
Body-breaking stuff.
Yeah. Yeah.
Was there much socializing amongst the businesses?
No, no, but I used to go to Mac and Max to pick up a lot of hardware.
Okay.
And I would, traps. I used to go there to get sometimes automotive equipment for what we were doing, parts. Fog Motors. There was the GM dealer down there too. I forget the name of it. Fog was, Westminster Motors, I guess maybe it was. Because I remember Jim Gifford bought a brand new 1953 Buick. He loved Buicks. I think he traded in a 48 and got a 53. And he brought it to the shop, and he was proud of that. And then he you know, the old guy must have liked me, but it was, you know, he never smiled because he had me take it down there, and the truck driver followed me to come back to have it detailed, washed, and cleaned.
Oh, wow. Yes. It
was his brand new Buick. Yeah.
I think that's probably a good sign.
Yeah.
I guess probably not the same day you were working at the tannery.
No.
And how about the pubs and things that were along Columbia?
Terminal.
The Windsor Terminal. Yeah, Terminal. Did you go there?
No, I was too young. But yeah, okay. I heard about the Terminal Club. And
yeah, that place has been going for a while. It was quite new at that time, too.
Yes, it was.
It was built in the
40s. Yeah, and the Russell Hotel.
Yeah.
How
about the Windsor Hotel?
No, I don't think I was in the Windsor. No.
Okay.
I wasn't much of a drinker, and besides, I wasn't old enough, so.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Did the sailors come off and go to the pubs? And
oh, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, very much so. And of course, some of the women certainly realized that the ships were a good place to go and line up.
What kind of women?
There was always sailors looking for women, and there was always women looking for sailors.
Yeah.
So that went on. Yeah.
Is it well?
That's actually something it's funny, a lot of interviewees have mentioned it, and no one ever wants to go into it at all, you know?
Mm-hmm.
It seems like they were definitely there, and that's, it's interesting to hear it come up.
Mm-hmm.
And one fellow had mentioned that sometimes they would sort of work out of the pubs, you know, they would sort of socialize in the pubs with the guys
yes.
that came off, so.
Yeah.
Yeah, but nobody really... No, and the first thing everyone says is, oh, I didn't know because I wasn't in there. But I heard, you know, that the women were there. Because I was going to ask in all this, were there women who were working alongside you? Or were there women?
No, it was very much a man's world.
Women weren't allowed to drink in the pub in those days.
Yeah, that's right.
It was quite a few years later, wasn't
wow.
it?
Wow.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
The
and
Windsor
then
Pub had two, Windsor Hotel had two entrances.
Yeah,
the ladies
I was just
going to
say.
Oh, wow.
My mom told me about that.
Oh, yeah.
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 And then, I can remember my memory, too, being downtown and having the parade and watching an open convertible with this guy sitting in the back seat, and he was gyrating around and yelling, and everybody on the sidewalk was cheering, and he was, who the hell is that guy think he is? It was Red Robinson.
Oh,
no,
you're kidding.
Yeah, it was some kind of a parade up. And they were playing with loudspeakers, you know, rock and roll out of the vehicle. And
yeah.
He was, I don't know what the parade was, but he was sitting up there as the rock and roll DJ, you know.
Might have been one of the May Day parades.
Pardon me?
Could have been one of the May Day parades.
It was a May Day parade. Yeah. You've got it. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, so there's lots of little memories, and I'm sure I'm only glossing them over. But New West, interestingly enough, has always been a special place for me because I am, in those 5 years, that was my formative years, and I many, many times I was sent out to interface with various merchants to get bits and pieces of this and that for the machine shop, and so I got to know quite a few of them. Mac and Max was, you know, I went to a lot, New West is a special place, you know. I think you know that.
Oh yeah.
Was it kind of a small world along the waterfront?
Very much
sort of
a small
knew
world.
All the shops along. And
yeah.
The,
yeah. Yeah, and Front Street, of course, was always unique places along Front Street. There was a tailor down at the foot of Sixth Street, just as it hits Front Street.
Yeah.
A Chinese tailor, and he was famous for making zoot suits.
Oh,
really?
Do you know what zoot suits
are?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And kids from Port Coquitlam would come in and get measured up for a zoot suit. Thank God I never had one. But the Beattie Armory had, after the Second World War, the Beattie Armory in Vancouver, you know, had a lot of reservists there. And New West was having quite a problem with zoot suiters, and they were walking, you know, along the sidewalk Saturday night down Columbia Street, and they were pushing people off the sidewalk.
Oh my God.
And, you know, acting like real ass ends, and they had their chains that hung down, you know, and their wallets and all that thing. So, one night over in the Beattie Street Armory, I guess the sergeant or the commanding officer thought it was a good exercise in crowd control. Let's take the bus over to New West and see how many zoot suiters we can straighten out. And that's what they did.
Oh, my goodness.
And they said, and we'll be back, too.
Really?
Yeah, if you continued doing what you're doing.
Wow. It's interesting.
But it must have worked, because I don't remember ever seeing any.
Yeah, well, I think...
West all the time.
Yeah, I don't know how... I can remember coming, as a country kid, coming into New West 2 on a Saturday and just amazed to see the Holy Rollers.
Mm.
Oh, really?
Have you heard of the Holy Rollers?
Only vaguely. I'm not sure exactly what they were.
Well, I don't know much about them, but there was a religious sect. And they would start, you know, on a street corner, and they would start chanting and a lot of vocalizing. And they would get themselves completely worked up, and then they would start throwing themselves on the sidewalk and rolling.
Oh.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it was... You've seen in pictures in Africa where they can get on Beetlejuice or whatever and start dancing until they can, you
into
know,
a frenzy.
A frenzy. Well, this was some type of a frenzy they got into. Mm-hmm.
Oh, wow. And when would that have been?
The 40s.
Okay.
So, you were speaking of Front Street a moment ago.
Yes.
And you were essentially working at Webb and Gifford 52 to 57, more or
58,
less?
58 is when that was signed, but I would say... 57, probably December 57.
So you probably recall when Front Street was covered with the parkade.
Yes.
How did that change things? Did it change things a little
bit? Oh, tremendously, tremendously. It took away a lot, and it changed the waterfront. And before that, it was open, there was along the dock side, there was Mac and Max originally, I think, moved around the corner.
Well, they're up.
Yeah. But they had a number of hardware stores. There were ships channelers and others supplying the merchants. the merchant ships that came in. There was rope, cable, chain. You know, there was a lot of things that ships needed.
Yeah, because I know that parkade, I think it was 57 it was put in, but I'm not 100% sure. And the attempt with that was to really draw commercial business into New Westminster and mm-hmm. to focus people to the Columbia Street area a bit more.
Yes.
But it was downplaying Front Street, or it had the effect of downplaying Front Street.
It certainly
was
did.
That direct access to the waterfront.
Yeah.
And I'm just wondering if that change.
Yeah, it did for me. Westminster Tent and Canvas were down mm-hmm. there. And then, you know, another vista that just came out on memory, if you will. You know that slope that comes down from the Patella Bridge, the railway, comes down on a diagonal
yeah.
to
mm-hmm.
the road, it comes down that hill. I can remember one day looking out of the blacksmith door and down came about four or five hobos, I guess,
okay.
for want of a better name. And
yeah.
they came down and turned into the blacksmith shop and went into our washroom in there and were doing their wash and cleanup for the day.
Oh, wow.
And I said to one, I was an inquiring person, I said to one of them, you know, you seem to be very familiar. I guess I hadn't been there that long. I said, you seem to be very familiar with this place and all its amenities or something like that, you know. They said, well, certainly, you know, when you ride the rods, you get to know where everything is. And
wow.
we've been here before. Once a year as we come through, we know it's a good place to wash and clean up for the day. And, you know,
oh, wow.
Yeah.
So would that have been a kind of, maybe not a common, but a recurring experience maybe of businesses along that?
I would think so.
Street.
Absolutely.
Wow.
Yeah. Riding the rods, and especially, I guess, because of the design of the cars, the freight cars then, you could ride the rods easier than what you could today.
Mm-hmm.
Riding the rods was almost an accepted, you know, for a certain group.
Lifestyle,
they,
yes.
They really saw themselves as free spirits, and in the Depression, it was desperation. After the war, if you were still riding the rods, it was because, for a new word that we all know now, they were street people.
Right.
With a means of getting around, yeah.
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 And they had their own culture, and they loved, you know, they weren't hardship
right.
cases per se. They were by choice. And, yeah, I think there was a number of them came into New West because of the railway and came in and out again.
And were the business owners, okay with them coming in and just
I was surprised at it.
And...
I was surprised at, yes, at just how open the whole process was. Yeah.
Yeah, that does sound interesting, because you always hear stories of people trying to push the hobos out of town and get rid of them.
That's right.
I don't know if that's just an urban legend now or something like this.
No,
or if
it's
there was...
not an urban legend, because in Port Coquitlam they had the marshaling yards
yeah.
for the CBR, and it was huge, because all the trains that were being made up for the east, were there was the big round, turntable in Port Coquitlam, and they were made up there, and... in between the marshaling yards was this, we called it hobo jungle. And it
right.
was a huge amount of shrub and swampy area, and they had camps and tents in there. And my father, I hadn't seen this, but my father told me that the provincial police officer, because they had become a problem, begging from door to door,
mm-hmm.
and then the mayor and council had said, this I'm going back into the 30s, and said, you know, we got to move these people out of town. You know,
right.
they're just a scourge on our citizenry. And the provincial officer used to ride a horse in order to get down into the jungles, and he had a riding crop, and he'd go down there and get them moving. When the eastbound freight was leaving, he'd ride through there just timed half an hour before that, and tell them to get up and get going and
get onto the outward train.
Yeah, on the outward bound train and drive them out of town.
But there were some in the 30s that were looking for work, because I know my grandfather
yeah.
rode the rails looking for work.
Right. Oh,
along the
yes.
highway.
Yeah,
yeah,
and I did say that, dear,
yeah.
that in the 40s there was a different
breed,
or a different reason.
Mm.
No, in the 30s, absolute starvation and desperation,
mm-hmm.
yeah.
That's fantastic.
Yeah.
There's a grad student at SFU, actually, who studies the hobo jungles.
Oh.
And that's his whole project is
on
that. Yeah, so he'll be interested to hear that it came up. It's actually come up within a few interviews. People have mentioned it.
No, I can remember this clearly. This is to me as a roots, it's my root story. But I would say it was 1942. I was born in 35, so I had to be about 7 years old. And a knock came on the door, front door, and it was at just the evening tide, just getting dark. And this wasn't begging. This was, this fellow wanted Dad to sign a petition. And it was a petition to close down the camps, the relief camps.
Yeah.
And he talked about the desperation of once you're in a relief camp, you know, you have no means to get back out to look for work. And the conditions were abhorrent and so on and so forth. And I think Dad signed the petition to close them down. But those relief camps were whatever. I'm sure you know some about
they
those.
They seem to be a topic of public conversation anyway for people.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, they... A lot of hard times. And then Dad was, wrote his exam and became a psych nurse up at Essendale. But before that, he was what they were called the attendants, because psychiatric nursing didn't have a certification in those days. And he was working on with a work gang, because in those days, physiotherapy work was considered, if you were physically able, was one of the best treatments for those mentally ill people. And he was out there with a work gang one day down near the highway, and they were putting up these dry stone walls, taking rock and stacking it. And the dry stone wall is still there along there. And there was a bow gang coming up the railway, which is just across the highway there. And he laughed and told me the story that the patients went down, leaned over the dry stone wall, and hollered across to the bows on the tracks, "Yay, yay, who's crazy? We get clean sheets and 3 squares a day. Yay, yay, who's crazy?" And as Dad said, a number of them that were in there that could have functioned outside, there was no jobs, there was no place to go. They got grounds privileges. Some of them got day privileges. And it's hard to understand that sense of desperation where you just stay where the hell you are, even if it is in a mess.
Subverting
the system
almost, though, using the system for...
There was 5,000 patients up there.
Wow. You know,
and about 1,500 staff.
Unbelievable.
So, it was
China.
A small town. Anyway, I know that time runs on
for
others.
I think we'll wrap up there. That was an excellent interview, though. Thank you so much.
Yeah.